At the conclusion of the 2008-2009 season, New York Philharmonic principal clarinetist Stanley Drucker celebrated 60 years as a member of the orchestra. In honor of this milestone anniversary, he became an honorary member of the Philharmonic Symphony Society of New York, the first orchestral musician so honored. His professional accomplishments and career longevity are unparalleled in the world of music. He's recognized in the Guinness Book of World Records for longest career as a clarinetist. The New York Philharmonic estimates that he has performed in 10,200 concerts, which is approximately 70% of the total number of their concerts since 1842. He was principal clarinetist for a record 48 years, playing under 9 music directors, among them Bruno Walter, Dimitri Mitropoulos, Leonard Bernstein, Pierre Boulez, and Zubin Mehta. In short, Stanley Drucker is the greatest living orchestral clarinetist and one of the greatest clarinetists of the past century. It is my pleasure to welcome Stanley Drucker to celebrate his magnificent musical career. Stanley, you were born in Brooklyn, New York on February 4th, 1929.
A good year. That was the year of the crash.
Tell us about your parents.
Well, they were immigrants and probably liked folk music and pop stuff that was on radio at the time, but they weren't musicians. But they saw the benefit of studying a musical instrument, and I remember an early musical experience in Brooklyn, looking out the window of the apartment house we lived in, and seeing a musician with a clarinet in the backyard playing klezmer. And people would wrap coins in pieces of newspaper and throw it out the window to this fellow. So you see, there was certainly a big influence on me. And and I think after a while, at the age of 10, I think it was, I received a clarinet for my birthday. And it was, I remember that instrument, it was, of course, the Goodman Shaw era. And it was a big influence on people that wanted their kids to do something more than they did, working in little factories or shops. They managed to get a teacher that would come to the apartment. I guess they called the union, the musicians' union, and the fellow came and he sort of got me started. Of course, it was a very slow go. I really didn't want to practice anything. I was more interested in going out and playing ball because of it. But anyway, the clarinet was a slow start for me. But after a while, it sort of became part of what I did. So you just stayed with it. And this teacher was a very nice fellow. He played saxophone and clarinet and probably doubled on flute or something else also. And after almost a year, he went off on tour with a dance band. He never came back. I guess I scared him away. But at that point, there was a little music store, mom and pop shop, in our neighborhood in Brooklyn. And the people that owned this little shop recommended Leon Rushinoff, who they had knew, and he was a fairly young man who still was living with his parents in that neighborhood. And I started studying with him at that point. I think I was 11 at that time. And he was a very serious person that really could draw good things out of almost anybody. And I think I was certainly a blank sheet of paper, and I think he put all the lines in and the colors and everything else. It was without really knowing much. Everything was new for me, you see.
Did you work on standard materials, would you say?
Yes. He used to, you know, he would write in a music manuscript book little exercises that he wanted me to do. And he used the typical Behrmann and Rose and Closé, and you know, all of the famous books of the time, and I would say there was no schedule or routine as to the amount of work. I just seemed to play everything through, probably five times faster than it had to be, but. He made a joke years later, saying I did a book a week, that kind of thing, you know. But it was certainly as a kid, you didn't dwell very much on the psychology of it or the philosophy of playing an instrument. You just did it. They said put this finger down and you did it. Take this much mouthpiece in, and you did it. You didn't, and if you screwed up, it wasn't a calamity. I guess 20 years later, it could be a calamity, but not at that point.
Tell us about how you ended up going to the Curtis Institute.
I was enrolled. I won entry to the High School of Music and Art in New York, which was an audition. School, you had to audition to get in, and students were from all the five boroughs of New York, and I took the subway every day up to uptown Manhattan, where the school was on 135th Street and Convent Avenue. It's a great school, actually. They had six orchestras and two bands, and there was a rehearsal. There were rehearsals every day, and somebody said, "Why don't you audition for Curtis Institute, in Philadelphia?" Because there you could be any age. They had little violin geniuses at 8 years old fiddling away in this place, and it was free, no tuition, and a small school, a little over 100 students. So I took the audition for Curtis, and I remember warming up in a room there. It's a beautiful old mansion. That's the school, you know. It was Elizabeth Arden, I think, the cosmetics fortune, you know. And the director of the school was the Curtis family from the Saturday Evening Post and other publications. Mary Louise Curtis Bach. One son became president of Harvard, Derek Bach. And I think she married one of her husbands later on in her life, Mary Louise Curtis, married Ephraim Zimbalist, the violinist, the Russian violinist, who became president of the of the Curtis Institute at that time. So the school was very nurturing. It was it was like a family. Anyway, I warmed up in a room, a small room, and there was another young guy like me warming up in the room also. His name was Robert Marcellus. He was from Minnesota, Wisconsin. So we both warmed up together in that room and auditioned. The teacher at the time was Bernard Portnoy. Of course, it was World War II going on at that time. Now when he came to the school to give the lessons, he was in his uniform, Merchant Marine uniform. He was in the Merchant Marine during World War II, and he had been a principal in the Philadelphia Orchestra up to that point. So I guess I was lucky and I won the audition, talented too perhaps, but. They only took one clarinet, one flute. You know, there was always one opening because they never had more than four on a given wind instrument at one time.
Tell us, did you have any other mentors at Curtis?
Well, a very important person was Marcel Tabuteau, the great French oboist of the Philadelphia Orchestra. He conducted the ensemble, which played a weekly radio broadcast, which we all got paid for. And it was very, very good players. The really wonderful students of the Curtis were in that little orchestra, and Tabuteau was the conductor. And he was a tough guy to play for. He always said, "It's going to be harder to play for me than than for conductors when you get out into the professional world. And in a certain sense, he was right. He was very demanding, and he was inspiring. And certainly hearing him play in rehearsals and concerts at the Academy of Music in Philadelphia was a really exciting time.